The power of the heart is the strongest power in the world. It is the strongest power in the world. It is the power that motivates human beings. It is the power that controls human beings. It is the power of the heart. That's why, as we said, that Allah Jalla wa Ala spoke about the heart and make the heart as the criteria for success or otherwise. My dear brothers and sisters, how do we fix our hearts? How do we rectify our hearts? What is the medicine of our hearts? There are a number of things. I would like to mention them quickly. I have a very, very limited time. I will mention seven things. Seven things. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، dear respected brothers and sisters، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. The topic that we will be dealing with today is a very very important topic. This topic that we are dealing with is the main criteria for our success or otherwise. No one will be successful in this dunya or in the hereafter except he comes to Allah Jalla wa Ala with a sound heart. The heart is the main criteria, as we said, for our success or our failure. That's why we would like to speak about the heart, the medicine of the heart. My dear brothers and sisters, the heart is the main element of the human being. In fact, we can say that the heart is the main element of the society. In fact, we can say that the heart is the main element of the humanity. In fact, we can say that the heart is the most important element in the whole creation. Allah Jalla wa Ala looks at the heart. إِنَّ اللَّهَ نَظَرَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. As the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in the hadith when he spoke about himself and how he was appointed as the messenger. إِنَّ اللَّهَ نَظَرَ فِي قُلُوبِ الْعِبَادِ. Allah Jalla wa Ala looked at the hearts of the people. In the hadith, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that إِنَّ اللَّهَ Jalla wa Ala, Allah Jalla wa Ala does not look at your bodies nor your shapes, but Allah Jalla wa Ala look at your hearts and your deeds. Allah Jalla wa Ala looks at your hearts and your deeds. Also, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, the dua of Ibrahim that is well known for all of us. When he says, Ibrahim alayhi salam doing dua, and we all know that Ibrahim among ulul azmi min ar-rusul, and Ibrahim, as Allah Jalla wa Ala says about him in the Quran, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقٌ. He is one of the siddiqeen, the few siddiqeen and prophets. وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ إِنَّهُ كَانَ صِدِّيقًا نَبِيًّا. And Allah Jalla wa Ala praised Ibrahim alayhi salam, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ كَانَ أُمَّةً قَانِتًا لِلَّهِ. He was an ummah. Ibrahim alayhi salam in his dua says to Allah Jalla wa Ala, وَلَا تُخْزِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. Don't humiliate me on the day of resurrection when people are going to be resurrected. يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ. When on that day nothing avails, nothing helps the person except those who come to Allah Jalla wa Ala with what? With a sound heart. Allah Jalla wa Ala also says, لَا يُؤَخِذُكُمُ اللَّهُ بِاللَّغْوِ فِي أَيْمَانِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا عَقَّدْتُمُ الْأَيْمَانِ وَلَكِنْ يُؤَخِذُكُمْ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ. Allah Jalla wa Ala does not count on you, but Allah Jalla wa Ala counts on what your hearts have earned. That's why the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in the very famous hadith, that the hadith that we all know about, إِنَّ الْحَلَالَ بَيِّنْ وَإِنَّ الْحَرَامَ بَيِّنْ, حديث النعمان بن بشير in the 40 Nawawi. All of us know about this hadith. In that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, indeed, there is a morsel. There is a piece of flesh in your body. If it is sounds, then the whole body becomes what? Become sound. If it becomes corrupted, then the whole body, the entire body, will become what? Corrupted. What is that piece of flesh? What is that organ? It is the heart. That's why we need to talk about the heart more and more. And we need to talk about what rectifies our hearts. We need to talk about the medicine of the hearts. My dear brothers and sisters, we are facing so many challenges in the West. And sometimes we think that the solution for those challenges starts from a political perspective, or maybe from a social perspective, or maybe from a da'wah perspective, or maybe from another angle, or maybe the Mahdi will come one time, or maybe we need to do jihad, we need to do this and that. And the solution for all of our problems, my dear brothers and sisters, the solutions for all of our problems come and stem from our hearts. It is the beginning. It is the beginning. If we rectify our hearts and we have pure hearts, the hearts that Allah Jalla wa Ala called them al-qalb al-salim, wa la tukhzini yawma yub'athun yawma la yanfa'u malun wa la banun illa man ata Allah biqalbin salim. The qalb munib that Allah Jalla wa Ala mentioned in Surah Qaf, inna fi dhalika la dhikra liman kana lahu qalbun aw alqa as-sam'a wa huwa shahid. Inna fi dhalika la dhikra liman kana lahu qalb. There is a remembrance, there is in this remembrance and guidance. For who? For those who have hearts. But those who do not have hearts, they are not going to benefit. So we need to have the pure hearts that Allah Jalla wa Ala wanted from us, and that will be the start for all of our, that will be the start of the solution for all of our hearts. Yes, I do agree that we need to rectify our hearts, and we need to do so many other things along with rectifying our hearts. Otherwise, we might be like the extreme Sufis who think that, yes, just fix our hearts or fix your hearts and everything in the world will be fixed. And once they talk about fixing the hearts, they are talking about it from a very limited angle. So either they made a mistake in understanding what fixing the heart means, or they made an wrong understanding by thinking that iman is limited to the heart and there should be no external actions by the limbs. No. That's why Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah believe that the iman is the actions and the statements by the heart. The actions and the statements by the heart, and also the actions by the limbs and the statements by the tongues. Four things. Actions by heart and by limbs. Statements by tongue, yes, and by heart. Four things. It was summarized by some people to say that belief in the heart, or belief by the heart, or actions by the heart, actions by the limbs, and the statements by the tongue. Either three things or four things. Four things is more comprehensive. What does that mean? It means that the heart works in synchronization with the entire body. And if we understand the body, the human being, correctly, we will never separate between the three powers of the human being. The three powers are what? The intellectual power, the spiritual power, and the physical power. All of them work together, and the king of all these powers is what? Is the heart. And Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah ta'ala says that the heart is nothing but the commander, the king, and the limbs and the other powers of the human being are nothing but soldiers, and he is the one who is commanding them to do this or to do that. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, ala inna fil jasad mudghah idha salahat salaha al jasad kullu wa idha fasadat fasada al jasad kullu ala wa hiya al qalb. Indeed, there is a piece of flesh in the body. If it becomes sound and good and righteous, the whole body will become what? Good and right and sound and righteous. If it becomes corrupted, then the whole body becomes corrupted. Subhanallah, my dear brothers and sisters. My dear brothers and sisters, despite the importance of the heart, we do not put that much attention to rectify our hearts. We do not put that much attention to fix our inward side. We always fix our outward side, and we don't pay that much attention, or we pay little attention to our hearts and our inner part. While the inner part is more important than the outer part. It is true, as we have said, according to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that all of them work together. And that's why we can understand the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah that we have just highlighted, that al-Iman is a combination of the actions of the heart, the actions of the limbs, and the statements of the heart and the tongue. We can understand that the actions of the limbs will increase the iman of the heart. The iman of the heart will be reflected on the limbs, the external powers or the physical power. No one can claim that his heart is pure and outwardly he doesn't or she doesn't practice Islam. And there might be some people who claim that they are outwardly practicing Islam, but inwardly they are not practicing Islam, and they are the hypocrites. And hence, we will come up, understanding this leads us to come up with three categories of people. The first category of people are either the believers or the disbelievers. This is the first category. The believers or disbelievers, they are either believing outwardly and inwardly. Yes? Or disbelieving outwardly and inwardly. This is the first type. You can say two types. And on the other side, there is what? There is the hypocrites. They believe outwardly, but inwardly they disbelieve. They are the hypocrites. And the third type of people who claim that they believe inwardly, but they don't believe outwardly, they do not exist. They do not exist. It is, as Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, never mentioned them in the categories of people. You cannot imagine that a person believes in his heart, but he or she does not practice anything from Islam. This is not there. Now, we understand the importance of the heart and the dynamic of the relationship between the heart and the other powers. As we said, the external power or the physical power and the intellectual power. Moreover, to understand the dynamic between the relationship between these three powers, what is the heart? The scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah try to identify or try to define the heart. What is the heart? Is it that piece of flesh that rests in your breasts that is there? Or is it linked to the intellectual power? Or does it lie here? Where is it? And once we say that there is a ruh and there is a spiritual power, where does this spiritual power or ruh lies? Where does it lie? Does it lie in this piece of flesh here or where? And just to cut it short, the scholars of Ahlul Sunnah said that the qalb that Allah Jalla wa'ala praised in the Quran, it is not only the physical organ that lies in the breast of people, of human beings. No, it is not that only. It is the flesh, that organ, that is connected with a super power, a spiritual power, yes, that cannot be touched, that is not physical. The combination between both is al-qalb. The combination between both is al-qalb. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. Indeed, when people become blind, they don't see the truth. They do not see the truth, not because they become physically blind, but because their hearts become blind. How that flesh becomes blind? No, it becomes blind because the spiritual power that is connected to it, or the ruh that is connected to it, won't be able to distinguish between what is right and what is wrong. My dear brothers and sisters, this was an introduction about the heart. And the conclusion of this is the power of the heart is the strongest power in the world. It is the strongest power in the world. It is the power that motivates human beings. It is the power that controls human beings. It is the power of the heart. That's why, as we said, that Allah Jalla wa Ala spoke about the heart and make the heart as the criteria for success or otherwise. My dear brothers and sisters, how do we fix our hearts? How do we rectify our hearts? What is the medicine of our hearts? There are a number of things. I would like to mention them quickly. I have a very, very limited time. I will mention seven things. Seven things. The first point that I would like to mention, my dear brothers and sisters, remember we will mention seven points. Yeah? And I would like all of you to take notes. Yeah, take notes, one after another, please. Otherwise, we will just listen, we'll come out of the lecture, and we do not remember anything. Yes, we would like to benefit from the lectures, not just benefit and then not just enjoy while we are attending, and the benefit will be minimum. The first thing, my dear brothers and sisters, the first element is Iman. Iman, as we said, mainly lies in the heart of the people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "At-taqwa hahuna, at-taqwa hahuna, at-taqwa hahuna." The taqwa is here, the taqwa is here, the taqwa is here. What does that mean? It means, my dear brothers and sisters, make sure that when you practice Islam, that your heart is there. Make sure that when you do anything, that your heart is there. Make sure that your heart is present with you all of the time. Make sure that you talk to your heart. Make sure that your heart talks to Allah Jalla wa Ala, and there is a direct link between your heart and Allah Jalla wa Ala. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَجِبُ مِنْ قَلْبٍ غَافِلٍ لَهُ. Know that Allah Jalla wa Ala does not accept the dua of a person who has a what? Or whose heart is heedless during the dua. What does that mean? When you make a dua, yes, like the people who make dua when they do tawaf around Kaaba, they just repeat after the person who's leading the tawaf. They just repeat the dua. They don't think about the dua. Their hearts are not present during the dua. So they just repeat certain words, and they might make mistakes in repeating certain words because their hearts are not present. And this is a big mushkila. Many of us, when we start our salah, Allahu Akbar, and then we start reading Surah Al-Fatiha in a very automatic way, the heart is not there. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the person attends the salah, and he attains sometimes half of the reward of the salah, fourth of the reward of the salah, one-tenth of the reward of the salah. Why? Because Allah Jalla wa Ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. The essence of khushu' in salah is that your heart is present during the ibadah. If the heart is not present during the ibadah, then there is no khushu'. Then the ibadah will not be counted at that time as a ibadah for you, so you will not get reward for it, full stop. So that's why, make sure that your heart is present all the time. Make sure that your heart is present in the ibadah, and make sure that your heart is communicating with Allah Jalla wa Ala even outside the ibadah. And this meaning is the meaning of dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala. This is the essence of remembrance Allah Jalla wa Ala. Yes, the scholars spoke about the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala by the tongue. But they said the highest level of the dhikr is when there is a synchronization between the dhikr by the tongue and the dhikr by the heart. They said this is the best type of dhikr. And they said the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said hadith Abi Darda and al-Hakim, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said ألا أنبئكم بخير أعمالكم وأزكاها عند مليككم وخير لكم من أن تلقوا عدوكم فتضربوا أعناقكم ويضربوا أعناقكم وخير لكم من أن من إنفاق الذهب والورق. Then the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, the translation of this, shall I tell you about the best of your deeds? Better than spending gold and silver for the sake of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Better than jihad fi sabilillah. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala said, what is that deed that is better than what? That is better than jihad. What is that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, dhikrullah. Ibn Hajar said, how come the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala is better than jihad? He said, yes. Because that dhikr is the true remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala, when the person remembers Allah Jalla wa Ala by his tongue and by his heart, and most importantly by his heart. That dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala is the ikhlas. That dhikr is the ikhlas that is mentioned, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهُ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. That dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala is the dhikr that motivates the person to do all good deeds. And that remembrance of Allah Jalla wa Ala is the remembrance that stops the person from committing bad sins. That's why it is the ikhlas. It is, in fact, he said, it is the level of ihsan. When you worship Allah Jalla wa Ala as you see Allah Jalla wa Ala. Yes? So, make sure, my dear brothers and sisters, that your heart is there all the time. That you talk to your heart and let your heart communicate with Allah Jalla wa Ala all the time. Once we say that your heart is communicating with Allah Jalla wa Ala all the time, this means that you are making dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala by your heart all of the time. So this is the first element to rectify our hearts. This is the first cure. This is the first main element of the medicine of the heart. Secondly, my dear brothers and sisters, write it down. Yeah? Al-amal al-salih. Doing good deeds. My dear brothers and sisters, many of us want to go to Jannah easily. Many of us want to have spiritual hearts, spiritual life. They want to enjoy spirituality. Many of us complain that their hearts are hard. Many of us think that there is a bottom in the body. Once you press it, then you will become a spiritual person, your iman increases. When you ask people, what do you like to talk about? What do you like me to talk about as a speaker or as a sheikh or when I give khutbah? They always ask for what? Spiritualities. They always ask to talk about the heart. They always ask to what? To talk about what increases your iman. They think that, many people think that increasing the iman, it is a matter of what? Of drinking water. What is that medicine that once we drink, khalas, our iman will be high, will increase, and will remain high. It doesn't work like this. We need to work hard in order to increase our iman. One. Moreover, we need to continue working hard in order to keep our iman high. If we leave good deeds for a while, then the iman goes down. And people feel depressed. And they say, oh, Sheikh, I feel that my iman is low. What can I do? And the answer is very easy. Follow these steps. And the second step that we have mentioned is what? Al-amal al-salih. Allah Jalla wa Ala always mentions al-amal al-salih. Illa alladhina amanu wa amilu al-salihat. Wal-asr inna al-insana lafi khusrin illa alladhina amanu wa amilu al-salihat. Inna alladhina amanu wa amilu al-salihat. Allah Jalla wa Ala always mentions this. Amal al-salih. Just to cut it short, my dear brothers and sisters, I would like every single one of you to have a plan for al-amal al-salih, for good deeds. Yes? A yearly plan, a monthly plan, a weekly plan, a daily plan. Let us start with the daily plan. How many of you, my dear brothers and sisters, early in the morning, when they wake up early in the morning, yeah, plan for the good deeds that they want to do for that day? Yes? For example, I have to read my Quran today. When I will read it? So I have to put a plan. Half an hour in my day to read my Quran. Also, I want to make sure for the brothers to pray jama'ah, and for the sisters to make sure that I'm praying my daily prayers, my five daily prayers in khushu' on time. This is part of the plan. Part of the plan for all of us, my dear brothers and sisters, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the very authentic hadith that all of us are aware of, the one who prays 12 rak'ah a day, Allah will build for him a house in Jannah. 2 rak'ah before Salat al-Fajr or Salat al-Subh. 4 rak'ah before Salat al-Duhur. 2 rak'ah after Salat al-Duhur. 2 rak'ah after Maghrib. 2 rak'ah after Isha. We pray our furud here. Yes? You do not see that every single one of us is keen to pray the 4 rak'ah before Duhur. You do not see that all of us are keen to pray the 2 rak'ah after Duhur. Why is this? You don't see that all of us are keen to pray the 2 rak'ah after Maghrib, the 2 rak'ah after Isha. This is part of your daily plan. Part of the daily plan, my dear brothers and sisters, is the dhikr of Allah Jalla wa Ala in the morning and in the evening. Yes, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam once was sitting with his companions, and he says to them, is it difficult for one of you to earn 1,000 hasana and to remove 1,000 sayya? They said, how can we do that? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, to say subhanallah wa bihamdihi one day, 100 times, Allah jalla wa ala will give you 1,000 hasana and will remove 1,000 sayya. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, the one who says subhanallah wa bihamdihi 100 times in the morning and subhanallah wa bihamdihi 100 times in the evening, no one will come on the day of resurrection with better deeds, except a person who did what he did and more. This is part of our plan. When are we going to make our dhikr of Allah Jalla wa'ala? My dear brothers and sisters, after salah, you will see that it is a bad habit that many of us have. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us to what? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam encouraged us to do istighfar. It was the habit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised doing the tasbih 33 times, the takbir 33 times, and the tahmid 33 times. All of us know this. But the question is, who is doing it consistently? And then we don't do it, and then after some time we ask, Sheikh, what is the problem with our hearts? Yeah? What is our problem with our hearts? The problem of our hearts is you. Is you. Why? Because Allah Jalla wa Ala commanded us to do so many good deeds. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived these deeds. We have a life example in front of us. We have life examples from the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum, but many of us don't put that into practice. So I was saying about the good deeds. Have a plan for your good deeds on a daily basis. Have a plan for your good deeds on a weekly basis. Have a plan for your good deeds on a monthly basis. Have a plan for your good deeds on a yearly basis. Of course, we do not have much time to go through these plans, but you should plan for yourself. So this was the second thing. So the first thing we mentioned is al-Iman. Treat your heart. Let your heart speak to Allah Jalla Ala. The second thing that we have mentioned is doing good deeds, and in particular plans. Daily plan, weekly plan, monthly plan, and yearly plan. The third thing, my dear brothers and sisters, whenever I come here and whenever I meet good people like yourselves, especially young people like yourselves, I speak about what? The importance of Quran in our life. ألف لام را كتاب أنزلناه إليك لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور بإذن ربهم. قل هو للذين آمنوا هدى وشفاء. يا أيها الناس قد جاءتكم موعظة من ربكم وشفاء. Oh mankind, a mawa'idha admonition came to you from your Lord and what? A shifa. A shifa for what? Lima fi sudur. What is the topic of this lecture? The medicine of the heart. The medicine of the heart is the Quran. Full stop. If you, my dear brothers, my dear brother, my dear sister, if you find that your heart is hard and you need to rectify the problems of your heart, if you feel that your iman is low, as I always say, and it is a challenge, and I will just mention it briefly, my dear brothers and sisters, read Quran. Quran means what? Inna ja'alnahu Qur'anan Arabiyyan la'allakum ta'qilun. Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan Arabiyyan. Yes? Qur'anan Arabi. This is Quran. Okay? وكذلك أوحينا إليك قرآنا عربيا and so many آيات قرآن عربي. Yeah, read Quran means the قرآن عربي. Yes, the Arabic Quran. We can't say the Arabic Quran, the Quran which is Arabic. Yeah, read it every day for 20 to 30 minutes. Yeah, minimum 20 to 30 minutes loudly. And check your heart within 1 month. Wallahi, you will see that you will become a different person. And this is a challenge. And I always mention this challenge. Do you remember that I have mentioned this challenge before? Yes or no? Yes or no? And I always say to young people like yourselves, my dear brothers and sisters, many of you like are like my children. Yes, in terms of age. Yeah, and many of you like my little brothers. Wallahi, I care for you. I want khair for you. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, I cannot give you a better advice than encouraging you to memorize the Quran. Last year, I think I took a covenant from you to memorize what? Do you remember? I said next year I want you, all of you to memorize what? Juzu amma. I said this is the minimum requirement. Do you remember this or not? Brothers, sisters, do you remember this or not? How many of you fulfilled that condition? How many of you? Subhanallah, I don't see much hands. I don't see many hands. How many of you? Why? Shame on you. Shame on any Muslim who doesn't know how to read Quran properly. Shame on the young people like yourselves who know everything about everything. But when it comes to Quran, when it comes to the memorization of Juz'u Amma, they fail to do it, subhanAllah. They spend hours and hours every day on social media. But when you ask them, just 30 minutes for the Quran, oh, we don't have time for that. Oh, not now. The shaitan is the one who's telling you, don't do it. Because the shaitan knows that if you are away from the Quran, you are away from Allah. And the shaitan will become next to you. And then all the other problems will happen to you. Yes, brothers, so this is the third thing, reading Quran. The fourth thing that I would like to mention is remembering the Akhirah. Every single day, my dear brothers and sisters, for 5 minutes only, 5 minutes, whenever you are traveling, just before you go to bed, while you are waiting for the public transportation, while you are maybe going for work, for 5 minutes, around 5 minutes, think about the Akhirah. Think about the Akhirah. ذلك يعظ به من كان منكم يؤمن بالله واليوم الآخر إنما يعمر مساجد الله من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر. اليوم الآخر is mentioned a lot in the Quran. What for? For nothing? No, because Allah جل وعلا knows that once we remember اليوم الآخر, everything will become good. Yes, that's why we read in Surah Al-Baqarah, which is the main chapter in the Quran, and the begin, and in the, it is the first chapter in the Quran after Surah Al-Fatiha, after the opening. Alif Lam Mim, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة what? وبالآخرة هم يوقنون. وبالآخرة, if there is no إيمان in the آخرة, there is no إيمان at all. Yes, and Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described al-Iman, أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر. So think about the آخرة. The آخرة for human beings starts when we die. Yes, when we die. And that is the beginning of the آخرة of every single person. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam said in Hadith al-Bara ibn Azib that when the person dies, the Malaika comes to him to test him. Who is your Lord? What is your deen? Who is your Prophet? Which means that your Akhirah, the accountability, it starts. Think of that. Think of what will happen to you in the grave, my dear brothers and sisters. Think of that. I mentioned to you, and wallahi, when I think about this, it really affects me. I mentioned to you that my father, who passed away a few months ago, may Allah Jalla wa'ala have rahmah on him. And may Allah Jalla wa'ala make the grave, his grave, as part of what? Part of Jannah. And may Allah Jalla wa'ala make the grave of all Muslims as part of Jannah. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam said that in the grave, when the person answers those questions, Allah Jalla wa'ala will say to the malaika, give him furniture in his grave. Yeah? Ufrushu lahu means give him the furniture from where? From Jannah. So his bed will be from Jannah. His sofa will be from Jannah. The carpet will be from Jannah. This is in the grave. This is the furniture. This is the furniture. May Allah Jalla wa'ala make this the furniture of my father in his grave. And for all the deceased. Yes? And then Allah Jalla wa'ala says, open a door for him, yes, to Jannah. So he will be, while he is in the grave, he will be smelling the Jannah, detecting the fragrance of Jannah. We need to think about that as well, my dear brothers and sisters. So thinking about the Akhirah. The fifth thing that I would like to mention is, make sure, my dear brothers and sisters, that you stick with the brothers. With the brothers who remind you of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Many scholars said, three things make me interested in living in this dunya. Fasting long days, doing Qiyamul Layl, and brotherhood. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, we read in yesterday, طيب, إنما المؤمنون إخوة فاصلحوا بين أخويكم. We all know that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says what? The wolf eats the lonely sheep. So don't be lonely. Yes, in order to rectify your heart and to get medicine for the problems of your heart. So this is the fifth thing. My dear brothers and sisters, the sixth thing is have good akhlaq. Have good akhlaq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam says, the strongest thing or the heaviest thing that is put on the scale of the person on the day of resurrection is what? Taqwa and fear of Allah Jalla wa'ala. Allah Jalla wa'ala praised the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And because of his noble standard of character, he was the closest person to Allah Jalla wa'ala. And my dear brothers and sisters, I would like to emphasize on one element of the akhlaq, which is what? Humbleness. Subhanallah. One of the greatest scholars said that the rude person who have a hard heart is normally away from Allah Jalla wa'ala. And the person who has a soft heart, yes, is the person who is what? Who is humble. Who is humble to himself, to people, and to Allah Jalla wa'ala. So in particular, humbleness. Don't be rude. Yesterday we spoke about istikbar, arrogance. And Allah Jalla wa'ala hates arrogance the most. And that's why the biggest sin of Iblis and Fir'aun is what? Is arrogance. And that's why Allah Jalla wa'ala says what? Al-kibriya. الكبرياء is not arrogance, يعني means عظمة. Majesty is my garment. No one should challenge me in that garment. No one should claim that garment for himself. Yes? Okay. And the seventh thing that I would like to mention, okay, is علم. Seeking knowledge. Make sure, my dear brothers and sisters, and let me cut it short because of time, we have to stop here, that apart from the Quran that we have mentioned, you need to learn the meanings of the Quran, and this is the essence of ilm. Allah Jalla wa Ala commanded us to contemplate in the Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. We are talking about the heart, and Allah Jalla wa Ala mentioned the cure. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَى قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Shouldn't they reflect on the hearts, or have their hearts been concealed? Yes? So this is the first element of ilm, is to reflect on the Quran, to study the meanings of the Quran, to have circles among yourselves. Yes, brothers and sisters, or maybe husband and wife, to study and contemplate on the Quran. This is one thing. Also part of ilm, just to make it very simple, take the book that is called Riyadu Salihin. Yeah, read it from cover to cover. Riyadu Salihin. Riyadu Salihin has 1,600 something ahadith. All of them are authentic hadith. Maybe one or two ahadith that are questionable. Don't worry about this. It covers all aspects of Islam. You need to know them. It gives you an overall view about Islam. Read Riyadu Salihin from cover to cover. Every day, make sure that you read 3-4 ahadith only. Don't say, I will read 100 hadith. I will finish the book within 1 week. No. Okay, because you will not be consistent. Just 3 ahadith, contemplate on them, try to understand their meanings. And for the young brothers, if they want, for the young brothers and sisters, those who want to increase their knowledge, listen carefully, take the shortest book in Aqidah, take the shortest book in Hadith, take the shortest book in Seerah, take the shortest book in Fiqh, take the shortest book in Usul Fiqh, the shortest of every discipline, and study it and make a plan to finish that book within 2 years. And you will see that after 2 years, you have a strong understanding of Islam. Jazakum Allahu khairan. A lot to be said, but let me summarize the points that I have mentioned. I don't know whether you have written them or not. Have you written them? Don't say yes. I'm seeing many people are not writing. So what was the first point that we mentioned? To rectify our hearts. What was it? Iman. Secondly, العمل الصالح, doing good deeds. The third one, what was the third one? What? Recitation of Quran, excellent. And what was the fourth one? What? Thinking about the Akhirah, contemplation about the Akhirah, every day for 5 days or so, for 5 minutes or so. The fifth one? Okay, brotherhood, sticking with the brothers. Yeah, okay. What was the sixth one? Having good akhlaq, and in particular? Humbleness. Yes, akhlaq. And the seventh one was what? Was what? Ilm. Learning Islam. Yes, my dear brothers and sisters, please do write them. And do remind yourself all the time about them. May Allah Jalla wa Ala rectify our hearts. And don't forget the dua to fix your hearts. As the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to say, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O the one who turns the hearts, make my heart firm on your deen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
Is salah without khushu accepted?
Yeah, okay, this is a good question, in fact. This is a very, very good question. Why this is a very good question? I'm not talking about the technical part of it. I'm talking about the spirit behind the question. See, the shaitan comes to many of us and tells them, now the shaitan becomes like a sheikh. طيب. And then the shaitan is telling us fatwas that if you have no khushu', what's the point of your salah? Yeah, so don't pray. And I have seen many people who left salah because of this doubt. And this is a big problem. No, my dear brothers and sisters, there are certain things that Allah Jalla wa'ala commanded us to do, yes, irrespective whether we have khushu' or we do not have khushu', but we need to keep struggling to have khushu'. Yeah? We have to pray 5 times a day. We have to fast. Many people say, well, fasting is not affecting me. You say this, you claim this, but in reality, it is affecting you positively. Salah is affecting you positively even if you have no khushu' in salah. So don't say that it doesn't affect me. No, 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 no. Yes, salah in of itself makes you closer to Allah Jalla Ala. Obviously, when you have more khushu' in salah, it will be better for you. As we said, that the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, you get from your salah what you have, what you focused on. Yes? The time your heart is present. Outside of that, you don't have it from your salah. Of course, this is the meaning of what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. So, we need to pray and we need to keep struggling against ourselves, against the shaitan, in order to what? In order to make khushu' in salah, to get the maximum of the salah. Now, imagine a person, yeah, who had no khushu' in salah at all. This is very difficult to imagine. يعني since he or she started Allahu Akbar and he read Surah Al-Fatiha and then he read or she read a surah after Surah Al-Fatiha and they went for sujood and they said Subhana Rabbiya Al-A'la in sujood, etc., etc. And they did not have any moment of khushu', it is impossible to imagine. The other point that I'd like to mention, my dear brothers and sisters, and in particular sisters. Yes, sisters, are you listening? You are not listening. Sisters, are you listening?
Yes.
Please listen, especially revered sisters. Yeah, many of them, they are perfectionists. What does perfectionist mean? What does perfectionist mean? In Norwegian.
No, do you understand? It's the same word actually.
Yeah?
Yes.
Same word.
Yes.
Okay. Perfectionists, they think that everything has to be perfect. And because of this, yes, wallahi, they cause harm to themselves. And they think that, oh, I need to struggle to pray with full khushu'. And some of them, when they pray, they are like a machine. Yeah? They are like a machine because they want it to be perfect 100%. My dear brothers and sisters, and especially sisters, Allah Jalla Ala is so merciful. Yeah? Allah is so merciful. And Allah Jalla Ala rewards people for anything they do. So don't think that your ibadah has to be perfect 100% in order for it to be acceptable. No. Yes? No. طيب, a lot to be said, but inshallah, this will be inshallah enough. Yes.
Bismillah. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
I was wondering if you could put more words into humbleness. If you could give some comments on humbleness.
The what?
If
sorry?
You could give some more comments about humbleness.
Humbleness.
And
yes.
I have another question. And you said that the dua, the one which his heart is headless, his dua will not be accepted. So how headless are we talking about exactly? Heedlessness.
Heedlessness in dua would not be accepted. Is that something?
Yeah. Yes? See, the dua, see, my dear brothers and sisters, the word accepted, what does accepted mean? Yeah. What does accepted mean? See, we need to differentiate between two things, between acceptability or acceptance and validity. Yeah, validity and acceptance. For example, if you pray your salah, yeah, with the minimum requirements, your salah is valid. Your salah is valid. Valid means it has the main level of acceptance. Okay? Now, what did Allah Jalla wa Ala accept it all? Allah knows. No one can talk about the acceptance because it is with Allah alone. But we can talk about validity. Yeah? So, many people go to Hajj, and when they come from Hajj, they say, Sheikh, I made this mistake in Hajj. Is my Hajj accepted? We say acceptability lies with Allah. We talk about validity. Was it valid? If the conditions are met, then it is valid. Valid means it has a level of acceptability. Was it fully accepted or not? Allah knows. Yes? Now, our dua, when we raise our hands and we ask Allah Jalla wa Ala something, yeah? That in of itself is a ibadah. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in Hadith al-Tirmidhi, al-du'a huwa al-ibadah. Yeah? It is a ibadah. So we will be rewarded for it. And so we will be rewarded for it. Has it been fully accepted or not? Allah knows. Yeah? But moreover, in dua in particular, and in salah in particular, when your heart is present during the ibadah, then you will be rewarded for that time. If your heart is heedless, so you are making dua, Allahumma, Allahumma, inni as'aluka, tuwaffiqani, and you are thinking about something else, and your lips, yeah, it is like a lip service. Your lips just repeat this dua, and your heart is someone else. During that time, when your heart was heedless, you are not rewarded for that time. Yes? Same thing when you make salah. When you do your salah, and you read Surah Fatiha, and your heart is somewhere else, during that time, the malaika stopped. Yes, the malaika stopped recording rewards for you. When your heart becomes present again, then the malaika starts what? Recording hasanat for you. But the salah in general, if it meets the conditions, then the salah is valid. I hope that is clear between acceptance and validity. Yeah? Why we differentiate between this? Because acceptance, my dear brothers and sisters, is of different levels. Yeah? As the many scholars said, maybe two people will pray next to each other. One person's salah, yes, will go just above his head. And the other person's salah goes all the way to the sky. Because of what? Because of the heart. Yeah? And that is the acceptance issue. Okay. Jazakallah khair.
There's a brother who's asking, he's not practicing, he doesn't pray or something like that. And he's asking, what should be his first step to becoming a better person?
Yes, mashallah. Good question. So this is a brother who doesn't pray, doesn't pay zakah, doesn't do anything. What is the first thing that he needs to do? Excellent, excellent question. The first thing he needs to do is now. Yes? Now. I don't want to ask the brother or the sister to raise their hands now, but now he needs to repent to Allah Jalla wa Ala. Do it now, my dear brother. Do it now before you die. Because you don't know when you will die. No one knows when he dies. Wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, as I said in the lecture, think about the Akhirah. Wallahi, if you think about the Akhirah every day for 5 days, wallahi, it makes a big difference in your life. If you think about death, if you think about the people who died, yeah, it will make a big difference in your life. Yes? That's why one of the early scholars, Yahya ibn Kathir, he said, the one who remembers death a lot, he will have three things in his life. Yeah, he will do a lot of good deeds, and he will repent, and he will be content with something minimum. Yeah, he will be content with something minimum. He will do good deeds, and he will what? He will repent immediately. So the first thing you need to do, my dear brother, my dear sister, is to repent to Allah Jalla wa'ala. Repent to Allah Jalla wa'ala means what? Say internally. Now. Don't forget that. Say, Ya Allah, I am coming back to you. Ya Allah, forgive all my sins. I promise you, Ya Allah, to come back to you and to become a better person. In fact, my dear brothers and sisters, we all should do this now. All of us, not that person who thinks that he is sinful or evil. Shall we do that now? Yes or no? Yes, how long this will take? How this will take? How long this will take? 1 hour? Seconds, subhanAllah. Repentance, my dear brothers and sisters, will take seconds from us. And wallahi, in many cases, we forget to do that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam says, by Allah, I make repentance to Allah jalla wa ala every day 70 times. And I bet you that many of us forget to make one repentance every day. Just one repentance, one tawbah every day. In many cases, we forget to do that. May Allah jalla wa ala forgive us. So now, yes, for a few seconds, let us pause. Every single one of you, including myself, including everyone, including the camera people, yes, including Sheikh Siraj Wahaj. Yeah, Sheikh Siraj, it doesn't mean that you are a big sheikh, you don't really need repentance. Astaghfirullah. Sah? Agree or not?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, astaghfirullah, Sheikh. Yeah. Yeah, Fahad. You repented already. May Allah Jalla wa'ala accepted it. Yes, I'm not joking. Do it, ya brothers, ya sisters, all of you. نسأل الله جل وعلا أن يغفر لنا ويرحمنا. Okay, so that is the first thing you need to do, my dear brother, my dear sister, to repent to Allah Jalla wa'ala. And repentance to Allah Jalla wa'ala means that you internally have a promise with Allah Jalla wa'ala. Speak to Allah Jalla wa'ala now. My dear brothers and sisters, subhanAllah, we are not like extreme Sufis. We are not like Christians. طيب. We are not like all of these. We can communicate with Allah Jalla wa'ala directly. Directly. We don't need an intermediate. Yeah. This is the beauty of Tawheed. That you feel that you have the power to communicate with your Lord directly. Subhanallah al-Azim. So communicate with Allah Jalla wa'ala and have that urge and commitment to continue on your repentance. This is the first thing. Then, my dear brother, my dear sister, the things that we have mentioned in the lecture, the seven things that you have mentioned, start doing them one after another. Yes, when the salah comes, pray your salah. Make your dhikr after salah. Do your sunnah, okay? And then when you go back home or when you have time, read your Quran. And then have a plan to learn and humble yourself. Yes, and do all the good deeds that we have mentioned. Jazakallah khair. طيب, next question.
Many people say that they don't want to be practicing before they clean their hearts. Is this right?
They don't want to be practicing before they clean their hearts.
Yeah.
Yeah, and those people are miskin. They will never practice the deen. Yeah? They will never practice the deen. I know, and I can see this future. Do you agree or not? Yes or no?
Yes.
Why? Don't just agree for the sake of it. Why do you agree that these people will never practice the deen?
Because they will never feel that they have cleared their
Because
heart.
Who, mashallah, has what? A very pure, clean heart. Apart from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Can you claim that, mashallah, you worked hard on your heart and your heart, mashallah, became what? Became white like the milk? And mashallah. Yeah? Subhanallah. Moreover, my dear brother, my dear sister, it means that you did not understand the lecture. Because what did we say in the lecture? That we said that the human beings have what? Three powers. What? The spiritual power, mainly in the heart, the intellectual power, mainly in the brain, and the what? The physical power. We said that all of them work together. Are you following? So you cannot claim that your heart is pure and clean and you do not pray. MashaAllah. Yes? You cannot tell me that, astaghfirullah al-azim, astaghfirullah al-azim, someone is watching pornography, yes, 4, 5, 6 hours a day, and brother, wallahi, my heart is clean. Can you believe in this? Can you believe in this? Sisters, one sister, I don't want to wear hijab. Why, my dear sister, you don't want to wear hijab? Because hijab is just a physical thing. As far as your heart is clean, you don't need to wear hijab. Yes, you don't need to be Muslim if your heart is clean. Agree or not? You don't need to pray if your heart is clean. Khalas, don't pray. Yeah? Do all evil things and your heart is clean. Does it work like this? No, my dear brothers and sisters, please don't listen to the shaitan. Don't listen to the shaitan. The iman, as we said, goes up and down, up and down. And iman increases by good deeds and decreases by what? By bad deeds. Jazakumullahu khaira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.